please welcome Sarah Silverman. When was the last time you got a dick pic?
I got, by the way, that exact same text. I did.
What a victory to get that every morning at 6 a.m.
I mean, don't enjoy it.
If you're not gonna, like, see them, I don't wanna see a picture of a penis head.
Oh, I do.
Well, that's good to know. I didn't really realize that about you.
Huh.
And I spent the whole night with you last night. I watched your stand-up special, and then I watched the movie, The Book of Henry, that you're in, but I think I did it in the wrong order because I took an edible after the stand-up special. And then the movie's pretty heavy shit. And so then I was just bawling in my room, you know, like crying, hi, and with Tammy and Chunk not even paying attention to me. I mean, it was embarrassing.
Wrong order.
Yeah, it was the wrong order. You could have given me the heads up.
I didn't know you were watching it.
Well, yeah, of course I'm watching it. Everybody should be watching it. It's on Netflix right now. But let's talk about the movie first, because you play a waitress in the movie, and I don't think you... Have you ever played been a waitress in real life?
Or yes.
Oh, I didn't think you had done that.
The first time I ever saw a penis was waitressing.
When you asked one of your customers to text it to you?
No, yeah. No, this is true. The boss at the Margaritaville Lounge, it was my first job, I was 18, and he called me into the office. I was, first of all... The whole computer system when you're a waitress, I remember when I was learning it, it was so daunting, and I remember thinking, there's no way being a lawyer is harder than this. It was like, it's so complicated.
It's a nightmare learning that stuff, absolutely.
So I get called into his office, I'm terrified I'm in trouble, and he's just like one of those fucking pink-faced Irish Boston guys, you know, and he's like, you having a good time working here? And I'm like, yeah, everybody's really nice. And he's just asking me these innocuous questions. And then I look down, and he fully has his dick out and is jerking off his dick. And men don't do that to women like us now. They do it to 18-year-olds like I was, who had never seen a penis and was terrified and, like, just said, I have to go clean the popcorn machine and left and never told anybody.
First time I saw a penis was on a beach in Martha's Vineyard, and I remember a guy had his dolphin shorts, you know, those gross dolphin shorts that people wore in the 70s, and his ball was just, it was more the ball. The ball was sliding out of the dolphin short, and I was, like, walking by with my sister. I'm like, oh, my God, what is that hairy thing coming out of his shorts? And she's like, don't look at that. And then I thought, I got home later that day, and I was like, oh, fuck, was that a ball? Like, I had heard about balls, but I had never laid eyes on a ball.
Balls are a mysterious mistress. I am a ball man. I like balls.
You do?
Yeah, do you?
No, I'm not really into balls. I don't like that they're also, they're very, like, surprising. You know, like, it's not just one uniform thing. They're all over the place. They can be big, small, hairy, not hairy. I don't like the surprise.
I don't like small, tight, bald.
Yeah.
I'd rather have low, hanging, hairy.
Yeah.
I don't know why. The heart wants what it wants.
I want to talk about what you brought up in your stand-up special because I loved it. I like that you did a small room, like not a huge stadium in these arenas, because it's... And they all seem the same, and it's nice to change the pace.
I feel like stand-up is supposed to be in a small room.
Yeah, I think you're right about that, because that way you can have a connection with everybody. You talk about your mom and, like, growing up with, political parents, and that you're a Democrat. Well, I don't want to say what you say in the special. Talk a little bit about that, because...
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, do it. Do your act right now. Get up and fucking do it!
What?
Like, politically, how you end up being a Democrat.
Sure,
you were raised by Democrats.
You know,
so.
We did a I did a show that for Lady Parts Justice, you know, Liz Winstead's thing that she does that's amazing and...
That helps get people to Planned Parenthoods in Texas, right?
This foundation was... I mean, this particular fundraiser was literally for women in Texas. They had gotten down to only 5 open abortion clinics. Of course, it's, like, much worse now, even. But, you know, Texas is huge. So we were just raising money to literally, like, give women in Texas so they could afford a babysitter so they can drive 12 hours to get an affordable mammogram or an abortion or a pap smear or whatever. And there were protesters outside, you know, right-to-life people. And And I just say, when I talk about it, that I'm not gonna shit on them because they think differently than me. We're the same. I'm the product of how I was raised. I happen to be raised by a couple bleeding heart liberal Democrat Jews, and now I am one. And I'd love to think I'd get there on my own, but probably not. And if I was raised by their parents, I'd be out there, you know? And there was like a 9-year-old girl there with a huge sign. Abortion is bloody murder. And the bloody was like dripping down. And that's when I realized like, oh yeah, they had to like go to Michael's or Blick's today and buy crafts.
But people who are raised like that, you can't blame them for thinking like that. You know, that's the thing. You're absolutely right. You find yourself so far apart with these differences. And actually, it's like, oh, we both were raised by parents who loved us and taught us what they believed in, and now we believe that.
And I'm in awe of people like you who are not necessarily the product of how
were raised. My mom didn't even know when there was an election. She didn't vote. She was just happy to be in the country because she was from Germany. And it was kind of like, she came over after the war. My dad talked about politics nonstop, but never voted. So all he did was bitch and moan about it. I feel like he's somebody who would vote for Donald Trump just to be a fucking asshole, you know?
Yeah.
Like he's that kind of person who talks about it all the time but never is active and never helps anybody or does anything about it. So, I'd like to think...
So how did you become you?
I saw my parents and I was like, I cannot end up like that. I was just like, this is not gonna... I don't like this house. I don't like the way you live. I don't like your bank account. I don't like your lifestyle. And plus, they didn't drink, so I was like, I'm out of here. But anyway, I want to bring up somebody who is also a tireless champion of women's health issues and also happens to be from the great state of Texas. She is the president of Planned Parenthood, Cecile Richards. Before?
Absolutely.
Yes.
And thanks for everything you do for women in Texas.
Oh,
appreciate it.
Thank you.
Really good.
First of all, congratulations on 100 years of Planned Parenthood, because I think a lot of people didn't realize that Planned Parenthood has been around for 100 years.
Thanks for being with us to celebrate.
Yeah,
it was
that
amazing
was great.
Night.
Yeah, Hillary Clinton spoke. A lot of people were there on that night, and it was great to see. So tell us how what's going on with your job? What's going on with Planned Parenthood? How are you feeling about our administration?
Yeah.
Do you guys test for syphilis? Because I think he has it. Anyway.
Yeah, we can help with that. Obviously, this first, 4 months now, 4.5 months have been probably the worst administration for women that we've ever seen. So that's bad. We're fighting this healthcare bill where they're trying to basically not only end the ability of millions of folks to come to Planned Parenthood for preventive health services, but they're trying to make it where women are basically a pre-existing condition again, where we're going to have to pay more for health insurance. If we have a pre-existing condition, we can't get health insurance. And actually, just this week, memos leaked that the White House is going to try to get rid of the birth control benefit that women have in America, that 55 million women have. So it's pretty bad.
So basically, they want you to not have access to birth control, and then also, if you get pregnant, you shouldn't have access to handling your pregnancy. So they think people are just going to stop having sex?
It's amazing. It's harder to not get pregnant if you don't want to. It's harder to have a healthy pregnancy because now the estimates are you're going to have to pay as much as $1,000 more a month to get maternity benefits through your health insurance plan. And now, of course, as they want to end children's health insurance, it'll also be harder if you want to raise a healthy kid. So,
and these are all a bunch of guys, and they're all the Republicans in the Senate that are together. There's Susan Collins isn't in that group. There's no woman, right, that's working on this bill.
That's making it a lot easier for them because in the room, actually the room where at the White House they were having a meeting to determine the final details of the bill, and it was the Freedom Caucus with the White House, and I'm thinking, oh my God, if I could get a picture of that room, it's a room of white men. And then Mike Pence actually tweeted out a picture of it, so that made it a lot easier. And
he's great, isn't he?
Yeah, it was great.
Because it's not about our bodies, it's about their religious freedom.
Yeah. So that's basically who's making these decisions. So once I heard that they were actually going to now allow bosses to not cover birth control anymore, now it's going to be the White House initiative, I can't wait or I am waiting to see the White House go after Viagra coverage, because as far as I know, it's actually covered by insurance plans. So
yeah, Sarah talks about that in her special too, men being, about sperm and if...
Yeah, sperm is life. They have olfactory senses, so...
So tell us what, I know you've talked publicly about your experience with abortion, I have, and that helps destigmatize it and helps women to know, but that's not what Planned Parenthood is. Planned Parenthood doesn't just get federal funding for abortions, and people think that it does. So that's a fallacy.
Absolutely, and it keeps getting repeated by politicians who know better. But yeah, actually, this whole defunding of Planned Parenthood that's in this bill before Congress and before the United States Senate would block access for everything else that we do, all the preventive services, which is the vast majority of what we do. So you can't come to Planned Parenthood anymore. You wouldn't be able to come for birth control, for STI testing or treatment, for breast exams. We detect a lot of breast cancer at Planned Parenthood. And ironically, of course, abortion isn't paid for by federal funds, so this would have nothing to do with that. And of course, we're right now at a historic all-time low for teenage pregnancy in the United States, which we're really proud of, because we've gotten better access to birth control.
What role does Ivanka Trump play in this scenario? I mean, because you had talks with her, right?
I talked to her. I told her what we did. I explained in detail, we see 2.5 million patients every year. For a lot of women and a lot of young people, we're their only healthcare provider. But so far, the White House has been a total zero on women and women's health. And I think Ivanka's job now is that she's in charge of all women's issues. So this would be time to kind of step up.
What do you think, Sarah, do you think Ivanka actually has any? Because I always say this. I'm like, why isn't she doing more? And my friend's always like, you're over. She has no control. She's just another, puppet circling around him. Do you think that she has any influence at all?
I'm so dead inside when it comes to all of this. I feel so disheartened. I actually saw she follows me on Twitter, and I direct messaged her, and I was like, this is your chance. You are writing your life story here.
Yeah, I also feel like, I think I have such a personal problem with it, because my dad is an asshole. He's like a Donald Trump, but not successful, so it's not everybody's problem.
Right.
You know what I mean? It was just our family's problem, and he's dishonest, and he lies, and, he's a mess. But if he, and I would call him on it my entire life, I was like, you can't treat people like this. You can't do this. You can't lie. You can't cheat. You can't steal. I don't want to be anything like you. And the fact that I think that she doesn't call him out is why I feel, I know all women feel this way towards Ivanka right now, but I'm like, you need to tell that fucking asshole that this is an unacceptable way to treat women. We're moving backwards.
Yeah.
So, what can women do? Women who are watching, how can they chip in? How can they help? What can they do?
Well, I think the good news is, of course, that women are the resistance. So, thanks for your resist T-shirt. I mean, the women's marches were unbelievable. Folks can call Congress, and in fact, there was some research done the other day that showed that 86% of calls that are going into Congress are from women. So women are absolutely leading that. You can't go to a town hall meeting without seeing women in pink pussy hats and holding Planned Parenthood signs and showing up, and that really matters, because you just see members of Congress are canceling them right and left because they don't want to show up.
We need men to be showing up for women too right now.
Thank you.
Men need to be showing up for us.
It's if you look at who's actually pushing all this agenda, whether it's in the White House or in Congress, it's time for men to come get their people, because they are absolutely the ones who are going after everything that we fought for as women. Folks can definitely support Planned Parenthood. You can text DEFEND to 22422, and we can tell you what's happening in your city or your state or your town. Right. And we can still beat this bill in the United States Senate. It's really, really important to
do
that.
We just have to really be aggressive. And I know you're doing a show. Sarah's has a show coming out on Hulu, and you're going to bring people who have differing opinions and backgrounds together, right? Is that the sense behind it?
I'm hoping to, instead of just kind of connect with like-minded people, are we going to really try to connect with unlike-minded people and expose the fact that we're ultimately the same? And be funny at the same time. We'll see. It's going to be a puzzle. But, once you're one-on-one with someone, once they're both of your porcupine needles are down, which sometimes happens just with the first hug, hello, a lot of change can happen.
Absolutely. You can see Sarah in The Book of Henry in theaters June 16th and watch her comedy special, A Speck of Dust, currently streaming on Netflix. And go to PlannedParenthood.org for more info on women's health. Thank you, guys. since you got to the end of that video, I'm going to show you something that's going to blow your mind. I realize that I've never walked up this staircase on my set, and I don't know what's behind this door at the top, so we're just going to find out together. And
hey guys, hit the subscribe button right now for more videos.